And I said, praise the Lord. And you look at me like a bump on a cucumber. Hallelujah. Huh? Did you mean what you sung? You know, like I was listening over, he was talking about Dr. J. Vern McGee. I was listening to Dr. McGee one day, and he was standing beside this man as they were singing "I Surrender It All." And Dr. McGee looked at him and said, "Are you surrendered at all?" He said, "No, I'm just singing." I'm afraid sometimes that's what we do, aren't you? But this morning, let's pray. Remember some folks, Brother Don Stein and his family, lift him up in prayer. Brother Robert, sister is Barbara, is in intensive care at Elizabethan. Brother Jack Campbell will be going tomorrow for his treatment. Continue, Sister Betty Hamilton, sure, but continue to pray for her. And the Boyne baby, Wednesday night when, can you imagine, I said adult addiction, but it's hard for me to imagine a little baby born into this world, addicted to drugs. And what is it now? 2 months? And it's still, it screaming and all, and they're having to still keep it on because to keep it going from withdrawals. But remember this little baby, will you? Pray that God to touch this little one. And remember Sister Musette Sexton, pray for her. Stanley, he's back with us. He had some blasting done, got rid of those kidney stones, and he's glad they're gone, and I hope I never have them again as long as I live. But good to see Brother Stanley this morning. Crystal Thompson, she's having difficult breathing again. Asked you to remember her in your prayers, and then Ronald Nidifer, continue to remember him in your prayers, if you would. How many's got needs this morning? Amen. Well, let's lift these needs before the throne of grace and ask God to touch in a special way. Brother Jerry, would you pray for us this morning?
Father, we find ourselves helpless and hopeless without you, Lord.
Yes. Yes.
Lord, I pray today for preaching of the word. I pray that the power of God be upon Brother Roy.
God grant it.
May he preach, Father. May it change your heart, Father.
Yes, grant it, God. Grant it, please, God.
May it bring encouragement to the discouraged. May it lift up the downhearted.
Yes, grant it, God.
Father, we pray that the preaching of the word will have an effect today, Father, on someone, Lord. Let it change your heart, Father. Bless the service. Let everything that's done be pleasing to you, Father. For we ask it in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, who suffered and died for us. In his name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Choir, come on. And if you haven't joined us before, here's the invitation. Thank you. You know, our Lord loved us so much that when he left, he told his disciples, I will not leave you comfortless. I will send another. And he did. He sent the Holy Spirit. And on top of that, he said, I'm going to go prepare a place for you, that where I am, you can come be with me. That's my paraphrasing of it. Listen to this song, I've Got a Mansion.
Oh,
I asked Michelle to work on this song some weeks back, and what a voice that God has given her. What a blessing she is. And this song simply says, praise his name. When you're up against the wall and the earth is falling beneath you, praise his name, Miss Michelle.
Against a wall, and your mountain seems so tall, and you realize life's not always fair. You can run away and hide, let the old man decide, or you can change your circumstances with a prayer. Everything falls apart. Praise his name. When you have a broken heart, raise your hands and say, Lord, you're all I need. You're everything to me, and he'll take the pain away. Take the pain away.
You know, I believe that's the answer to a lot of our problems. We get down and depressed and discouraged. Praise his name. Just look up and say, thank you, God. Praise your name. Will you stand and help us with our last song, number 340? What a wonderful God we serve. This song says, he hides my soul in the cleft of the rock. Number 340, first, second, and fourth verses. God praise his name.
Well, good morning, and we certainly welcome you this morning to Oakland Avenue Baptist Church. And boy, I sure did enjoy the choir this morning. Man, oh man, they just overdid themselves, Brother Jerry. It's good, I tell you. Hey, if the preaching's half as good as the choir sung, man, you better leave right now. Amen. I tell you, was that good? Let me, if you're visiting with us today, we'd love to have a record of your visit. If you just lift your hand up as our ushers walk down, just hold your hand up. We'd love to have a record of your visit today. Hold your hand up, and inside that package, there's a visitor's card, and fill it out. A few moments, we'll receive an offering and drop that card into the offering plate. Did anybody lose a pair of glasses? Let me give you some prayer requests there. That Joshua Daniels, a young man up in Michigan, we need to really pray for him. And then Rob and Heidi, they had to go back home to Michigan. Rob's great-grandmother passed away, so remember them in your prayers too. And then this evening, on Sunday evening, we're preaching on the subject of prayer. And let me encourage you to be here this evening. And then our ladies will be meeting at 6 o'clock tomorrow evening to pray. Wednesday, we've got the Discover Club for the young people and children. And then in the auditorium, we'll be teaching Romans chapter 7, verse 14 through 25. And then Thursday, we'll be meeting here at the church at 7 o'clock for prayer. And we need candy. We need candy for the children's October the 30th. So we need you to bring a bunch of candy in so we can give these children and all on October the 30th. And then on October the 30th, on Sunday evening, we'll be having fellowship in the fellowship hall, and it's going to be soup and cornbread. Amen. Can I make a suggestion? And some banana pudding, too. And can I make a suggestion? It's just a suggestion, but maybe somebody would fix a big old pot of soup beans and bring about two big old onions about that big, and even maybe a glass of milk with that cornbread. The 30th, we're looking forward to Sunday evening fellowship on the 30th, so let me encourage you to remember that, if you would. And then remember, we are in a 40-day time of fasting and prayer. I announced this to you on September the 28th, that we were having 40 days of fasting and praying. Now, it doesn't mean you're going to go 40 days without eating, okay? That doesn't mean you're going on a 40-day fast. That means that during that time, you're going to take some time to fast and to pray. And especially for our youth meeting that's going to be on November the 5th with Brother Greg, we hope to have this place filled with teenagers on the 5th from all over the tri-state area, and really be praying for that. And then on 6th, Brother Greg, Sunday morning through Wednesday night, we've got, hey, over at Yuma, Virginia, back early in the year, Brother Danny Sykes had scheduled it was a youth meeting that started, and then Brother Greg, it went for 7 weeks. I'd like to see something like that break out in Johnson City, wouldn't you? Now, I'm scheduled to be in Florida the last week in November, but I would be glad to cancel that. Amen. You just act like you won't get rid of me. Okay. And by the way, about appreciating the pastors, God has given me two wonderful men here to fill in when I'm gone, Brother Charles and Brother Scott. Write them appreciation. Let them know you appreciate them. They might not be here pastoring, but they're sure here to help God's man. So So pray for them and honor them. I would encourage you to do that. All right, if our men have come, we'll receive the morning giving. If you didn't get a letter, see Jeff there, and he'll be glad to give it to you. Okay, all right. Just hold your hand up as you come by, and they'll get them to you. Okay, Brother Scott, would you pray for us this morning? Amen. 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 You know that I wasn't planning on being here this day. But you know the reason I stayed? See if you laid out of church this morning. Come on, Phyllis.
Maybe they can see me over this. We took our primaries and our junior kids on a field trip yesterday. We had 15 kids with us, had the primary teachers, Ray and Crystal, had some other helpers with us, Linda Dawson, Ann Shell, Michelle Kelly. I think that was all. Anyway, we had 15 kids with us. And I just want to lift up those kids. They were so precious. They were so good. They were so well behaved. We went to the Cooper Gem Mine over in Bluntville, and I have never seen 15 children any more well behaved than those children were. And I just want to, when you see those young children, they were from ages, what are your children's age? 5 to 8, and mine are 9 to 12, and they were awesome. And if you see those young children out, just tell them how proud you are of them, because they were so well behaved. And normally, well, in class this morning, they were wild. But yesterday, to represent God and our church, they did an awesome job. And when you see those little children, just tell them that, you know, hey, I heard you had a good time, and that you were awesome kids yesterday, because they were. And I just want to let everybody know how good they were and how proud that I am of them. I stood in awe of them yesterday I stood back and watched them sitting there mining for those little gems in those buckets and the strainers. And I just want you to know that how proud I am and how proud you should be of our youth that we are trying to teach and tell about God. And that's, I just wanted everybody to know about them. Amen. And I'm proud of them, and you should be too.
Amen.
By the way, our children, somebody might look around and say, where are the children? We've got children's church and all on Sunday morning at there over there. Some people don't believe you ought to have children's church. I've never been one of those. I think you can teach them over there and train them, and there's a time for them to come into the auditorium. Amen. This morning, I'd invite you to take your Bible and turn with us to the book of St. Matthew, chapter 5, verse 13. One verse for our scripture reading, and from this text, we will take the title for the message this morning. And I hope you have been in prayer, praying that God will mightily speak to our hearts. I've been praying and asking God to give me messages that will prepare our hearts for the meeting that we've got scheduled with Brother Greg Lynch. Am I on now? Amen. So follow with me as I read in your hearing, Matthew chapter 5, verse 13. And this is a message this morning to God's people, to the church. It doesn't mean that sinners cannot get saved. But it's a message speaking to the church, praying that God shall give us a burden and give us a brokenness for a spiritual renewal and a spiritual awakening. If you go back to verse number 1 of this chapter, the Lord is speaking to His disciples, to His followers. And this verse is addressed to the believer. He says in the very first word, you. Now, who are you? His disciples. You and I this morning that are saved, this is speaking directly to the redeemed, to the Christian. You are the salt of the earth. But if the salt have lost his savor, wherewith shall it be salty? It is henceforth good for nothing, to be cast out and to be trodden under foot of men. I entitle the message in that statement, Good for Nothing. Good for Nothing. I have a salt shaker before me that I hold in my hand this morning. If that salt is contaminated, it's unusable. But here's another thought about that salt. If that salt stays in that shaker, it's no good for nothing. As long as we keep the truth of God inside these walls, we believers are literally good for nothing. I hope that you will pray and be very attentively and let God speak to our hearts this morning. How many of you believe America is corrupt and rotten? If you don't, you've got your head in the sand like an ostrich. Get your head out of the sand and face reality this morning. Our nation's in a mess. Our churches are in a mess. Our families are in a mess. Our whole society is in a mess. And the only answer is for it to be salted by God Almighty. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this text that you've given us this morning. I pray he, the Holy Spirit, will help it to get off of the pages and to get into our hearts. Illuminate our minds and our hearts to understand the great truths that you want us to have from this verse this morning. Lord, revive us and do a mighty work in our midst. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Keep thinking about that subject this morning. Good for nothing. Have you ever heard this statement? He's not worth his salt. Now, these young people probably never, none of you young people never heard that, have you? How many of you over 50 years of age has heard that? Look at that. You think this society hasn't changed? I just proved it right here. He ain't worth his salt. He's not worth his salt. Now, I pray this morning that God will help us to really think about this morning, good for nothing. Salt. Salt is very different from what it is put on. The believer, the Christian, is supposed to be very different from what this world is. The disciples' character was salt. The disciples' place for the salt was on the earth. The disciples' mission was to salt the earth. But the disciples' danger was that they would lose their saltness and be good for nothing. Some things we know about salt. Salt preserves. It keeps things from going bad and decaying. Back in the days before we had refrigeration, the way that we preserved food was by salting it down. How many of you know salt back in the early days of the settlement was very, very important? I mean, down in Jonesboro, we got the salt house there that came from the salt mines up in Saltville, Virginia, and they brought the wagon loads down and stored it there because the settlers had to have that salt to preserve their food to be able to survive. So salt preserves. Salt penetrates. Cut a place on your hand and put some salt in, and what does it do? It stings. Salt penetrates, inserts a new quantity and substance in life. It changes what it touches. Salt flavors. Boy, how many of you just like that salt on them big old tomatoes? It just gives that. You take a big old bologna sandwich and you put a big old hunk of tomato on it. I mean, and then when you put that salt on there,
It might kill you, and you might go to heaven early, but it sure is good, right? There's something else about salt. Salt is quiet. Salt is quiet. It is visible, but it works silently. Salt spreads. Take a big old pot of mashed potatoes and you fix them up, and then you put that butter in there, and then you take that salt and begin to put that salt in there and you mash it up, and what happens? That salt goes through it all. But you know something? Salt can become good for nothing. The danger of the believer and the danger of the church is becoming useless, no good. Salt does not lose its saltness. Sodium chloride does not lose its saltness. And there's a long study here what the Lord is talking about. He's talking about the salt that they gathered in the days of Palestine. It was contaminated. And it would get to the place, it would become so contaminated, what literally the Lord was using an illustration and a truth that day. Our master, the Lord Jesus Christ, was the master teacher to get across his message. And he said, listen, when you're not what you ought to be, and when you're not doing my will, then you become contaminated with the flesh, the world, and the things around about you. And just like the salt that we've gathered from down at the Dead Sea, and you've tucked and placed, it has become contaminated with dirt and other substance, and the chemicals that were not taken from, and the people didn't pay attention when they was mining the salt, it's no good. And literally, they'd take it out like we'd take gravel today and spread it out and make paths and walk upon it. And the Lord is using that to help you and I as believers in the church to realize if we become contaminated, if we become in that state, then we become useless for the glory of God. This is a picture of a backslidden Christian. We used to use that word, you know it, in the church. We used to talk about backsliding. We used to talk about getting out of fellowship with God. We used to talk about wandering away from where we ought to be with our Lord and getting off of the path that we should be. Hey, I'm going to tell you something. I regard my testimony very highly. If I have no testimony, I have no right to stand here and speak to you. If I am not living what I believe and what I preach, I have no right and no privilege to be able to speak to you this morning. I regard my testimony very highly. When God saved me and called me to the ministry, I tried to pay my bills on time, and if I couldn't, I would make arrangements to the people because I regarded my testimony very highly. Jerry and I were sitting at the funeral home on Friday, and there was a young lady I hadn't saw in years. She walked up to the car, and she had asked somebody, matter of fact, she's part of the Tietrich family, and she said, who's the minister in this conducting this funeral? And they said, Roy Yeldon. What did you say, Jerry? I said, that's a good man. That's God's man. Was that what she said? I'd rather have that testimony and to know that I am respected as God's man as to have the whole world. I regard my testimony very highly. Hey, listen, if I have no testimony, then I become useless, just like contaminated salt thrown out